dystopian times.
Coming up, we have a really big event. This is the Medicare for All March taking place on July 24th. So there's going to be marches across the country. Hopefully the locations, okay. Locations are popping up, but I'll try to bring it up. Joy, can you tell us what is going on here, where it's happening, and how we can get involved and take place?
Yeah, so we started with one march in DC, and now we are at 28 marches nationally, with more being added. You can find the locations at m4all.org. I'll be the MC at the DC one. Our keynote is Marianne Williamson. We have Lee Camp. We have Margaret Flowers. We have a bunch of cool people. LA, Rob Saccone, Graham Elwood will be in Hawaii. So we have incredible, maybe a girl is the MC in LA. So, we have incredible people coming out to support this. It's actually 1 month from tomorrow, July 24th. So, I'm actually helping organize all of them. So I'm kind of going bananas, but
that's a lot of work.
It is, but it's very rewarding. It's the I've organized probably over 30, actions in the past 6 years, but this is my first event I'm doing since I went blind. So this is very special to me, and it's like, I get to prove to myself I can still do this. Like, I can still actually contribute to and do what I want to do. July 24th, we have so many locations. And then our Twitter is at M4M4ALL.
That's incredible. And I have the locations on the screen here. I believe that this is not the updated list. The link didn't work for me there. But so the website is m4m4all.org, something that I think is really, really cool. I love that this is taking place. And I feel kind of like, since it's happening in July, which is my birthday month, people are trying to fight for Medicare for All as my birthday present, which would be really great. So if
it's,
you want to get involved.
It's actually Medicare's birthday as well.
So. Is it really?
Yeah.
Well, they're a little bit older than I am. Medicare's older than I am. Yeah. And just to like kind of add to this. So before the pandemic, there was a study that came out, I think it was from Princeton University, I'm not entirely sure, but it showed that 68,000 people per year were dying because they didn't have healthcare. And I don't necessarily know if they're disaggregating like between people who just don't have insurance or people who had insurance, but they were underinsured. And so now after the pandemic, or during the pandemic, I should say, I can't imagine how much worse it's gotten. And I've spoken about this before as well on Twitter, that after my dad died, I don't know if my mom's gotten one lately, but she'll receive these bills for like ambulance rides, for hospital stays for my dad, after he's been dead over a year. And it's so, like, the system in America is so bizarre the way it's set up.
It's violent.
It's literally violent. And I also want to point everyone to a video from the New York Times. Talked about this on the Humanist Report, actually, where they basically talked to folks from Canada, from Australia, and it was maddening to see their reactions to how dysfunctional the American healthcare system is. And so since we have this topic up, does anyone have like a crazy healthcare story? Because one thing that I say on my show is, look, basically, if you live in America and if you've had to sign up for insurance, you have some sort of a story about how confusing it is, how difficult it is to navigate the system, going through. So I have Obamacare, right? Not necessarily the best in the world. I think I just signed up for the cheapest bronze plan that I can find. But when you look at all of the plans, it's extremely confusing. Even though you make your monthly payment, it doesn't cover everything. So you're spending thousands of dollars. And I mean, I feel like Medicare for All, it's a no-brainer at this point. And Jen from I'm blanking on the name of her show, so I'm so sorry, Jen. I want to give you a shout out, but I forgot your show's name. But she basically said, look, at this point, if you don't support Medicare for All, I put you in the same category as like the flat earthers. Like, that's how crazy you are, because there's no debate at this point. Like, it's cheaper overall. It reduces net healthcare spending. It saves lives. Generational change. I don't know why that was so difficult, Jen. I'm so sorry. But I love the point that she made there. It's you're like in the same category as flat earthers. And this is kind of where I'm at. So does anyone want to share like a healthcare story that they have? I know that Joy, you have a bunch with injections in your eyes. Like you shared, what is it, $12,000 per eye?
Per eye every 30 days. Yeah, so I just started going blind last year. So all of it was unpredictable. And, you know, I just woke up one day without most of my sight, and it's super rare. And I'm only, well, I was 40 at the time. And so insurance companies were like, we're not paying for it. It's rare. Like, and it's like, yeah, I'm totally making it up. I said to my doctor, is this some kind of kink I don't know about? Like, people actually ask to get in, you know, injections in their eye because, you know, they were refusing to pay for it. And I mean, it's just, so you're going through this trauma of becoming disabled unexpectedly and having your entire life just completely changed. You know, I have a cane, there's no driving, I can't watch movies, I don't even know how I do half the shit I do. But so on top of that, it's exacerbated by calling about pre-authorizations and my surgeries and all of those things, and just spending hours and hours every day on the phone trying to get things covered. So it really is a hostage situation where it's like, you know, you have like a real little bit of sight left, but we're just kind of gonna let that go too, unless you can pay, you know, XYZ. And thankfully, the lovely Marianne Williamson, Mike, and Ron Placone, you guys did a fundraiser for me. How I would have gotten through it, I just don't know. And, you know, I had to get all blind accessibility equipment and everything. And it's like Medicare for All would have changed my life.
My dad's side of the family, lots of them are in Georgia. My family is originally from New York, but lots of them are in Georgia. My aunt and my grandma lived in the same home. It was like a really small duplex. It wasn't the best place. They lived there for a really long time. I think as long as I've been around, and I'm 22 now. So quite some time. My grandma passed away, and we brought my aunt, to live with us for some time. She had some health issues, but the thing is, she never got it touched on because she couldn't afford the healthcare. That, and even if she did have the healthcare, like you said, they wouldn't pay for everything. So she was scared of, if something came up, if she ever knew about something, she'd worry about it. She was a very worrisome person. She'd worry about it more, and it made the healthcare worse. So just kind of imagine that it doesn't exist until it caught up with us. So we brought it to the house and everything, and we were finally getting her set up on healthcare, finally getting like everything set up. And she was going on for her first doctor's visit, first medical checkup in her adult life, that Monday, but the weekend before she passed away. Thank you. You know, it happens. So our healthcare system is absolutely like abominable. I have to say so. That's one of the big reasons that got me into politics in the first place, and got me into having healthcare be my like big issue. It's it touches a lot of people, and I do think like healthcare is like really one of those big things. Like for me, being in Kentucky, okay, not only on specifically the marches, I was able to go to the 1 year anniversary of Breonna Taylor's killing in Louisville, and it was an amazing time. Listen, all right, if you're lonely, a march is a great place to go. I met a really mm-hmm. cute girl, really nice. Hey. And you get to show out. I got to speak to her aunt and everything, and her mom, great people. So you get to do something that's good. You get to go outside, great, touch grass. I did it. I just really think that it'd be great for everyone to sort of get together behind a movement. And I live right next to West Virginia. One of my friends is actually from West Virginia, and his family is experiencing all the problems that come up with black lung and everything there, like the worst air ever. People just keeling over because of, you know, all of the problems with the air pollution there. I think that's one of the really big things that can get people moving, something that really affects them, especially a lot of people in coal country, oil country. Those people get really messed up.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
And speaking of that as well, there's this place called Libby, Montana. And when Lee Camp was on my show last time, we were talking about it. It is a place that, because of things that were in the air, it was making people sick. And they enacted immediate Medicare for all for this town, Libby, Montana. And at that point, everyone got 100% coverage. And if you look at the legislation, it does not say Libby, Montana in it. So that's one of our demands at the march, to enact Libby, Montana. They can enact it for literally our entire country just on that one statute.
Hmm. I mean, we saw actually a countrywide, a nationwide version of that actually with the COVID vaccine. You can get that exactly. Free of charge.
Exactly.
Yeah. And it's, I was honestly like, because we live in the United States, I was actually a little bit worried because I don't know about you all, but they did ask for my insurance card. And thankfully, I do have my Obamacare. But it's like, okay, when's the bill coming? Like, I know I'm going to get something in the mail, because it's like, it's traumatizing, like, to have any experience with healthcare. It's like, you expect the worst automatically. You think, oh God, I have like this. And maybe it's because I'm a hypochondriac, so I'm not necessarily the best gauge for this. But when I think, oh God, I'm sick, if this is something wrong, then is this going to be the thing that like bankrupts me? And it's such a twisted thing. Like, if you're sick, you should be worrying about getting better, not like how you're going to pay for this. Not if your family is going to be okay or bankrupted. You know, as was the case with my dad, you know, with my mom receiving medical bills. It's like, she should be grieving, not thinking about, oh my God, am I going to get sued for this? And we still don't know. It's like, you know, when you get a medical bill, it's not $20, it's like thousands. Did you want to say something, Denim?
Yeah, I wanted to say, and like, I don't think people, it's not that people don't recognize, but I think we forget the amount of like trauma that comes with getting hospitalized for any reason or having to go to the doctor for any reason. I have like a close relative of mine who got cancer, and luckily they had Medicare. So they got to go to a doctor. They were worried that they did. They caught it a little bit earlier, and they are doing well now. They're doing great. They, you know, survived and everything's great. And they don't ever have to worry about the stress of having to pay back literally hundreds of thousands of dollars back into this. And like, I like obviously repeatedly spoke to them when they were sick. And that is like the toll it takes on you. The idea that we have to have people go through physical pain, like in this case, it would have been chemo, then go through the mental toll of being like, how the fuck am I going to pay for this? And then also the mental, like just like the stress of just the mental burden that it is of just feeling sick. Like I'm sure everyone here knows about like the theory of like spoons. When you're physically sick, you just don't have energy to do things. Your energy is so limited. And like, we look at all this and we're like, yeah, we need to make sure these people pay hundreds of thousands of dollars, despite the fact that we don't have to make them pay this. Like, it's just depressing.